नमस्कार, वेरी वॉम वेलकम टू ऑल द व्यूअर्स एंड लर्नर्स इन दिस लाइव इंटरेक्शन ऑफ CIIT NCERT. आई एम रेणु भट्ट विद यू ऑल एंड यू आर वॉचिंग अस लाइव ऑन ई विद्या चैनल चैनल नंबर 9. एंड अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस मीडियम यू आर कनेक्टेड टू अस थ्रू आर यूट्यूब चैनल एज वेल, दैट इज NCERT PM ई विद्या क्लास नंबर 9. और इस सेशन में हम बात करने वाले हैं साइंस स्टैंडर्ड के 9th क्लास के स्टूडेंट्स के लिए. और हम आज जिस टॉपिक पे बात करने वाले हैं, दैट इज़ वेरी मच इम्पॉर्टेंट. और हम बात करेंगे द फंडामेंटल यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ इस टॉपिक पे. एंड एज वी ऑल नो, द सेल इज़ द यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ एंड सेल इज़ द स्मॉलेस्ट स्ट्रक्चरल एंड फंक्शनल यूनिट ऑफ लाइफ. इसके बारे में हम आज ज़्यादा डिटेल में जानने वाले हैं. एंड डियर लर्नर्स एंड व्यूअर्स, इन केस यू हैव एनी क्वेरी रिलेटेड टू दिस पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक और आप कुछ ज़्यादा जानना चाहते हैं, एंड इफ़ यू वॉन्ट टू शेयर योर एक्सपीरियंस, आप हमसे हमारे विभिन्न माध्यमों के जरिए जुड़ सकते हैं. आप हमें कॉल कर सकते हैं हमारे टेलीफोन नंबर पर जो है 8800440559. इधर यू कैन ड्रॉप अ मेल एज वेल. आर ईमेल एड्रेस इज dth.class9@cit.nic.in. एंड इन केस यू हैव जॉइन बाय आर यूट्यूब चैनल, दैट इज NCERT PME विद्या क्लास नंबर 9, यू हैव टू गो टू द लाइव चैट बॉक्स एंड देन ओनली यू कैन ड्रॉप योर कॉमेंट आउट देयर. आर एक्सपर्ट विल बी मोर देन हैप्पी टू आंसर ऑल योर क्वेरीज एंड डाउट्स इफ़ यू हैव एनी. एंड हम आप सभी की मुलाकात कराते हैं हमारी एक्सपर्ट से जो हमसे जुड़ चुकी हैं. आप हैं डॉक्टर शालिनी कौशिक लव, यू आर असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर बॉटनी फ्रॉम RIE भुवनेश्वरा ओडिशा. वेरी वॉर्म वेलकम मैम, स्वागत है आपका.
थैंक यू सो मच. थैंक यू रेणु जी.
So ma'am, we'll get to know more about the fundamental unit of life, that is cell. So ma'am, aapke paas kya kuch special hai hamare aaj ke session mein for all our students and learners, ma'am?
Yeah, my name is Shalini. I am there from Odisha, live with you people. And you people, please free to ask anything that you want to ask me. So first of all, we will start with the overview of the session, as if what the cell is. Who discovered the cell? We'll also talk about the cell theory, the contributions of different scientists who have contributed for the understanding of the cell and its component. We'll also talk about the diversity of the shape and the sizes of the cell. We'll talk about the structural organization, as if the cell is made up of what organelles, what are the different components of the cell that we will be talking about. And also the few components of the cell, we will be focusing about the plasma membrane, the cell wall, and the nucleus. We'll also talk about the different sorts of cell types in this session. So, aage chale?
Sure, ma'am.
Yeah. So, you know, if you see the level of organization, the cell lies at the base. The cell, you know, you and I, we are made up of cell, okay? It is the smallest structural functional unit of life. Not only you and I, if you see any plant, so what is the basic unit? The initial, the basic structural unit is the cell, okay? So it is not only the structural, but also the functional unit of the plants as well as the animals. And it is capable of performing all the important life processes, like we talk about respiration. So we have organelles in the cell which are responsible for the phenomena of respiration. We found photosynthesis and protein synthesis. So it is not only just the structural, but also the functional unit of life. So as you can see in the diagram on the right hand side, the cell is lying at the base. The different types of cells, they constitute the tissue, which further constitute the organ, and then the organ system, and finally the individual. That individual can be a plant, and that individual can be the human being or any animal like that, okay? So the question is, who was the great person who has firstly discovered the cell? So let's move further. So Robert Hooke, long back in 1665, you see, when the primitive type of microscopes were available, see, microscopes are the instrument which enable us to see the sizes which are microns in nature, like very small size, which you cannot see with the naked eye. So he had a primitive microscope and he took a piece of Cork is nothing but the, you can say, the outer bark layer. He took a thin slice of it and put it under the microscope, and he observed what is there, which is a honeycomb like structure that you can see, you know, at the bottom of his own picture. That honeycomb like structure, it is made up of what? It is made up of the small, you know, compartment, little compartments are there. So in the Latin, the little compartment or the little room is called as the cell. So finally, the name the cell has been given by the Robert Hooke. Aage chale. Okay, so how can you in your class observe the cell? You just take a piece of onion and, you know, prepare what is known as a peel mount. Okay, put a drop of saffronin or methylene blue, okay, which is there to stain. Staining will enhance the visibility because it provides the contrast. And the microscope, which is now available with us, it is a very, very advanced one. The one that Hooke had, that was not that as advanced that as compared to now. So you can prepare a slide that your teacher would guide you how to do that, and you can see here also, you can see these small compartments. These are nothing but the cell. Okay, so even in your class, small exercise can be performed and you can see the cell. Next. Now, people were working on the plants as well as the animals. Sheldon, he was basically a plant scientist. He was working on the plants, trying to see the structure of the plant cell. Schwann was a animal scientist. He was working on the animal cell. So he found that finally both of them, they have actually came to the conclusion that the cell is the basic structural unit. So both of them, they together combined and a cell theory was proposed. So what is the cell theory? The plants and animals are all composed of cells, and cell is the basic structural unit of life. So this cell theory was further extended by another scientist by the name of R. Virchow. He said that the all the cells, they arise from the pre-existing cells. So the life of an organism starts from a single cell, and that cell divides and gives rise to a multicellular organisms. Because we are made up of many cells, we are called as multicellular organisms. So the life, you know, it starts, the cells, they start divide. Okay, all the cells, they arise from the pre-existing cell, and the life of the organism starts from a single cell. Right. Aage chalte. Let's move further. There are other important contributions, like, you know, the Robert Brown. He was the one who discovered the nucleus. Okay, so in the previous slide only I have shown you those little compartments. In those there was a round which was there in the center. So those rounds are nothing but the nucleus of the cell. So Robert Brown was another person who was behind the discovery of the nucleus, and the person who's credited with the discovery of the microscope, which enables us to see different structures. Okay, that is Anton van Leeuwenhoek. He was the one who discovered the free living cells in the pond water, which is bacteria. And Purkinje is another scientist who discovered the fluid substance of the cell. So what is the fluid structure of the cell, which is there in all the cell, and that was called as protoplasm in 1839. We can go further. So you can see, like, if you see the human cell, you will find that there are different types of cells which are available. You can see different shapes, like we have red blood cells which are discoid, okay. You can see the columnar epithelial cells which are there in our intestine, okay. At the down bottom, you see the cells which are nerve cells. They have a different size and shape. You can see that the long processes are present. okay, in the nerve cells, in the sperm cell, which is also having a entirely different shapes. So in a multicellular organism, we have the cells of different sizes and shape, and majority of them relates to their function. Like sperm has to travel, so it is being provided with a tail. You can see down at the bottom. So likewise, we have different types of cells in a multicellular organism. So now the question is, does a single cell exist or not? So let us move further. Now you can see that, you know, these are the unicellular organisms. All of them are eukaryotes. Okay, eukaryotes, we'll talk about the eukaryotes and prokaryotes after a little while, but you can see that in all of them there is a red dot which is present in the center, that is the nucleus, which we earlier slightly mentioned also. So this amoeba is a single cellular organism on its own. It can perform all the life processes. Okay, it can, you know, take the food, it can perform the digestion, it can, you know, release the waste material. So these are free living unicellular organisms. Okay, so not only multicellular organisms, we have the free living unicellular organisms as well. Next, ma'am. So the cell is made up of, these are the important component of cell. Basically, cell kiska bana hai, it is made up of what? So cell is made up of the plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is nothing but the outer boundary of the cell. Okay, and you know, if we talk about the plant cell, the cell of the plant and the animal, they are little different from each other. We'll discuss about the differences, but the now to tell you that the plant cell has a cell wall in addition to the plasma membrane. So if somebody is asking you that the what is the outermost layer in the animal cell, it is the plasma membrane, and what is the outer layer in the plant cell, it is the cell wall. So plant cell as well as the bacteria, the fungi, they have additional layer which is very protective in nature. It is present outside the plasma membrane. Okay, then there is a very important organelle which is the nucleus, which is usually present in the center of the cell. Then the cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is the fluid substance of the cell. Okay, so it contains different organelles which perform different functions, like endoplasmic reticulum is there, Golgi bodies are there, lysosomes are there in the animal cell, and vacuoles are there in the vacuoles are there also in the animal cell, but in the plant cell we have a very large central vacuole which is present, not in the animal cell. So we'll further discuss, elaborate upon it once we'll reach there. Then the mitochondria, the chloroplast, these organelles, they perform different functions of the cell, and ultimately all these functions together help in performing the function of the organism, right? Next. So now coming, we'll discuss all these components one by one. So first, let's talk about the plasma membrane. So as I've already told you, it is the outermost layer of the cell that separates the content of the cell from the external environment. Okay, so it is quite protective. It's not that all the substances, they can easily enter into the cell. They have to cross this barrier, which is by the name of plasma membrane. And this membrane is selectively permeable or semi-permeable in nature. So what is the meaning of being selectively permeable or semi-permeable? It is that, you know, the few substances can pass through this barrier, but not all the substances. It, you know, very much distinguish what are the substances that can enter and what are the substances that it will not allow to enter. Okay, so that is why the term semi-permeable or selectively permeable is given. It is made up of proteins and lipids. Okay, and these substances move inside the cell by a process which is known as diffusion. So diffusion is mainly governed by the concentration gradient. The concentration gradient means if the substances are present at a higher concentration outside the cell, they will be able to enter the cell. If the substances are present at a higher concentration inside the cell, they will be able to leave the cell. So always the movement of substances are from a high concentration region to the low concentration whenever we are talking about the phenomena of diffusion. Okay, specifically this is true for the gases, okay, the carbon dioxide and oxygen, they also move in response to the concentration difference. Once the carbon dioxide, you know, increases, it has to go out of the cell, okay. So it goes out by the process of diffusion, and oxygen also, you know, when it depletes inside, the oxygen also will, you know, move inside the cell by the process of diffusion. Next. Now, I was talking about the movement of gases, okay, like carbon dioxide and oxygen. But when we talk about the movement of water molecule, so then we call it as osmosis. However, the osmosis has to be driven by the presence of a, you know, there has to be a presence of a semi-permeable membrane. Then the substances, if the water is moved from one side to the other side by crossing a semi-permeable membrane, this phenomena is known as osmosis. The above diagram, okay, here you can see that there is no semi-permeable membrane, okay, and the substances, they are moving, you know, in the open space. But here there is a presence of a, in the osmosis, there is a presence of a semi-permeable membrane where the water level is decreasing. If that black dot is not crossing, because the semi-permeable membrane, it doesn't allow the crossage of the movement of those black dots, it only allows the movement of water molecule, okay. So what is the osmosis? Osmosis is the net diffusion of water molecule through a semi-permeable membrane, and here the water will diffuse from a region of low solute concentration to a high solute concentration. I hope this is clear to all of you. Next. Next.
Yeah, please continue, ma'am.
Now, how this the phenomena of diffusion can be studied? Like you can see that there are, you know, in the diagram you can see that if a cell is placed in a solution that has a low solute concentration, very very dilute solution is present outside the cell, so the water will be able to enter the cell through the process of diffusion. And you can see that the upper cell is bursted because all the water has gone into it, it becomes turgid, that means swelled up and bursted. In the isotonic solution, the concentration of the water which is present outside the cell is similar to that which is present inside the cell. So when we have this sort of condition, then in that case there will not be any change. So there will not be no net movement of water molecule inside and outside the cell. In case of a hypertonic solution which is present on the extreme left side, when the cell is present in a highly concentrated solution, then what will happen? The water would move out of the cell, and you can see that the animal cell, the red blood cell, is now shrunken. So, and the plant cell, what will happen in the plant cell? It will lose the, the cell membrane will come away from the plasma membrane. So, that condition, you know, is known as plasmolysis. The cell becomes flaccid and the plasmolysis has taken place. So, here you can see, I have brought this. This is a leaf where, if you can prepare the slide from here, put it in the sugar solution, salt solution, and if you visualize under the microscope, you will be able to see the plasmolyzed cells, where you can see that in the center nothing but the cytoplasm, it has shrunken, okay, and it has, the plasma membrane has moved away from the cell wall, and this phenomena is known as plasmolysis.
Okay. So, ma'am, how can the phenomena of osmosis through an activity even without a microscope. Could you please? Yes, ma'am.
Actually, even if you don't have a microscope, you want to see whether the plasmolysis has taken place in a plant cell or not.
Right.
Then you, what you can do, like, you know, you take the raisins, for example.
Hmm.
If you put the raisins in the, you know, sugar syrup, you know, you will see that they are shrunken. Okay.
Hmm.
So that means that you can actually, this is a kind of an activity which we normally people do only. So that is because the raisin, it has taken out its water, whatever was there inside the raisin, it has now come outside in the concentrated cell salt, sugar or salt solution. So this can be done even with the help of potato. Also, one can know if you put the potato tuber in a concentrated solution, that what you will see that the weight will decrease. You weigh the potato tuber, you will see that the weight has gone down. So that can, even without a microscope also, one can know that the plasmolysis has taken place. And similarly, the other way around, even the potato will become turgid. If we put the raisins at night, in the morning, what we see that they are in the plain water, we see that they are swollen. So that is because of the turgidity. Okay.
Fine, ma'am. We have to wrap up this session as we are running very short of time right now. Shali, ma'am, thank you so very much for being with us and for this valuable information. Thank you, ma'am. And dear learners and viewers, we were discussing about the fundamental unit of life, and it's time for us to go for a break. Break ke baad hum apne ek aur live interaction ke saath hazir honge, jo ki webinar hai jisme 5 divasiya online prashikshan karyakram chal raha hai, jisme aaj 5va aur antim din hai. Aap yun hi hamare sath bane rahe, hum baat kar rahe hain webinar mein cyber hamlo ki. Abhi filhal mujhe Renu Bhatt ko dein is session se anumati. Namaskar.